and to good works. Yes, you should exhort one another, compliment one another, give credit where credit's due. You know, be good to one another. True Christianity. Not people mouthing each other off, getting in arguments constantly. I can't stand that, to be honest with you. I'd rather not talk to anybody. You know, I leave my comments on, so perhaps I could help somebody. That's the whole point of it. But then, you know, you get the legends in their own mind on there that like to give you a great big comment about how worthless and how you're a big piece of garbage and everything else. Oh, it's just wonderful dealing with people like that. But there's a block button, so just to let you know, if you're going to make comments like that, you know, I'm not going to humor you. I'm just going to block you. Because I got better things to do to argue with know-it-all know-nothings. Teaching me who the 144,000 Jews are. Apparently, Jacob only had, he had 12 sons. He named them all Judah, right? You do realize that the Jews came from one tribe, Judah, not all 12. You're going to school me on it, right? You know, I did have a facepalm meme that I was going to put up here, but it's not necessary. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much more, as ye see the day approaching. What day do we see approaching here? The day of the Lord. This is what this is in reference to. For if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. But Jesus just told us in Luke chapter 12, there's only one sin that cannot be forgiven. That's blaspheming the Holy Spirit. But Christians will take this, oh, if you sin willfully after you're saved, well, you're not forgiven. They'll say, oh, you weren't really saved to begin with. Unlike me, you know, I haven't sinned one time since I've been saved because I'm that good. And that's why Jesus is coming for me. That's why I'm getting raptured out of here, because I'm just that good. That's not what this is talking about. This is those who have come to the knowledge of the truth. How many people do you think are ready, willing, capable, and ready of allowing themselves to be delivered up, to allow the Holy Spirit to speak through them? How many people do you know how short the tribulation's been shortened to? Even though Jesus says he's shortened the tribulation, people are still going on, no, 7 years, yeah, yeah. Satan himself, that's Obama, that's the Antichrist, it's Obama. Well, Obama better hurry up and come out of the closet with it here pretty soon, you know. Tribulation was only supposed to be 7 years. Well, he was president for 8. You know, when's he going to come out of the closet anyway? For people that want to teach that tripe. There remaineth no more sacrifice for sins. Yeah, well, we've gone over this. If you don't allow the Holy Spirit to speak through you, if God has opened your eyes and you have full knowledge of the truth, you're liable for that. You know, if God decided to choose you to give you the truth, well, you're liable for it. And who is this directed towards? Is this directed towards the 7,000 very elect? Yeah, in a way it is, I believe. We're all, whoever the 7,000 very elect are, you know, we're all weak in the flesh, whoever you are. But what about those 144,000 that are sealed with the seal of God in the forehead? Those that were redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Perhaps that didn't overcome in the age that was, but have full knowledge of the truth. Somebody had to have taught them. Perhaps this is addressed towards them, maybe. I don't know. Just a thought for the deeper scholar. But a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. Yeah, you're right. A great white throat judgment. Everybody that's an adversary against God is done. They're blotted out, brought to ashes. Not burning forever, they're just destroyed. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Of how much sore punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy, who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant, wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. In other words, the Holy Spirit. Let's read this again. Of how much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy? Who be thought worthy? You be thought worthy. God opened your eyes. He's given you the knowledge. He's counting on you. He's depending on you to allow yourself to be delivered up, to have the Holy Spirit to speak through you. who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. What's this mean? It means that if you allow Satan to deceive you and you do not allow the Holy Spirit to speak through you, you have committed the unpardonable sin. You knew better. That's the whole point. You knew better. And you gave it all up for a few shekels from Beelzebub. I don't think it's going to happen, but hey, the warning's there nonetheless. Heed it and heed it well. For we know him that hath said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, saith the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Boy, I wish some Christians would really take this one seriously. At all the times God speaks out about those that prophesy from their own minds, from their own hearts, thus saying, thus saith the Lord, when the Lord did not speak to them, preaching a bunch of garbage, pre-trib raptures and this and that. There's so many contradictions and holes that can be thrown in that doctrine that even an elementary student like myself can throw holes all through that. But yet, they just want to hang on to it here. You know, they don't think it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the Lord. Well, you know what? I lose sleep over it. I walk around here pacing back and forth, not saying a word before I do these videos. Why? Because I don't want to prophesy from my own mind. I want it to only be God's word and God's word only, or I don't want to do it at all. But call to remembrance the former days, in which, after ye were illuminated, ye endured a great flight of afflictions. Yeah, you better believe it. When God opens your eyes, yeah, you're going to be tested. Satan's going to test you. I've had more crazy things happen to me in the last couple years that I can shake a stick at. But you know what? I'm still here. I'm still going. I'm still ready to go. Let's read this again. But call to remembrance the former days, in which after ye were illuminated, ye endured a great flight of afflictions. Boy, I remember when God first opened my eyes and I came across Mark 13 records. Then I started studying with Just Thought Studies. Then eventually Pastor Arnold Murray. I was spending hours and hours and hours a day watching 8, 9, 10, 12 hours a day of the Word of God taught chapter by chapter and verse by verse. And it just clicked. It was so beautiful. It made perfect sense. Common sense, everything. You know, it was so beautiful. And still to this day, I spend 7 or 8 hours at times a day studying the Word of God. Because it is my life now. And you can't help but love God when you learn the truth and understand what the first resurrection is, what the second resurrection is, what happens during the millennium. You know, all those lies I've been taught my whole life about what hell is and what hell isn't. You know, all those lies are gone now. What a beautiful thing it is to know the truth, to have your eyes open. Partly whilst ye were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly whilst ye became companions of them that were so used. Yeah, they had it rough. The first church. You think we got some persecution here, somebody making fun of me here and there? Well, big deal. Make fun of me. Who cares? Grow up if that's how you are anyway. They had it rough. For ye had compassion of me in my bonds, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and enduring substance. That's right. That's where the true treasures are. If you want great honor and great glory, serve God and you'll have it. He's promised it. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which ye have great recompense of reward. What are you going to do? Cast away all your rewards for a little bit of a pleasure for 5 months that Satan's going to offer? For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. That's right. You know, when those 144,000 are sealed, you know, Satan is coming, and then Jesus is going to return. And I believe it's going to happen soon. You know, 70 years, we're coming up on it, 2018. You know, what's 18? Number 18 is symbolic in biblical numerics of bondage. The number 20, symbolic of redemption. And I guess from what I've heard, there's a 72-year generation as well. That would bring us to 2020. You know, to me, you know, with the numbers and stuff I talked about in previous videos, you know, I've, you know, I got my eyes open. I'm not rushing. I'm trying to be patient. Hard for somebody like me to be patient. It is. I try, but it's hard to do. Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Draw back from what? Draw back from the faith. Especially if you have come to full knowledge of the truth and decide to draw back and count it as no effect. Like to worship Satan when you know better? Pretty stupid. But we are not of them who draw back onto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. And that's exactly what I believe. That's the whole point of this channel, is to praise our Lord Jesus Christ and our Heavenly Father. This isn't about me. I don't want no praise. I want our Father to have the praise. This is part of my repentance because I want to help people. I never even knew what true repentance was until I read the book of Ruth here not too long ago. Very beautiful book. Just happened to be read on Pentecost Day. I had no idea. Let's go to Acts chapter 2 so we can see what took place when the Holy Spirit spoke through them. Why? Because as Solomon said, there's nothing new under the sun. What has been shall be again. So if you want to know what's going to happen when the Holy Spirit speaks through us, well, it's already happened. There's nothing new under the sun. Let's read it and see what happened then. See how the people reacted. You know, people are people. Yeah, we got smart TVs, smartphones, smart cars, smart this, smart that, but people are people. And I'm sure they were a lot smarter back then than they are today. Because the majority of people I come across are... Never mind. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues, like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. What's this mean? Every peoples of the world was dwelling in Jerusalem. This word Jews means Iudas in the Greek. It can mean a literal descendant of the patriarch Judah or somebody that resides in the land of Judea. Just like here in Canada, we have every nation under the sun living in here in Canada. They claim they are Canadians, and they are. Same difference here. Not complicated, but people love to complicate it. You know what I'm saying? Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. Remember what I just got done saying here not too long ago? I'm speaking English, but somebody Chinese is hearing me speak Chinese. Somebody Russian is hearing me speak Russian. Somebody French is hearing me speak French. Somebody Spanish hearing me speak Spanish. Yet I'm speaking English. How is that possible? It's impossible. But anything is possible with God. Because when this takes place, this isn't you that's speaking. This is our Father speaking through you. You're just a vessel. I don't mean it like that to be rude, but that's what you are. You're a vessel that our Father shall speak through. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? Basically, aren't all these just the poor country boys? And how hear we every man in our own tongue, wherein we were born? Exactly. They're saying, how are we hearing them speak in our language? You know, imagine this taking place today. You ever watch David Blaine do some magic tricks, throw a card out a window and the card appears on the other side of the glass and people are mesmerized and freaking out as they levitate sometimes, move a couple inches off the ground, the people are freaking right out? What do you think when something like this happens? A real miracle. I bet a lot of Christians, when they find out that they're worshiping Satan, their stomach's going to be right up here. And I bet there'll be a lot of Judas types casting their silver back at Satan's feet. Parthians and Medes and Elamites, and the dwellers in Mesopotamia, and in Judea, and Cappadocia, and Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, and Egypt, and in parts of Libya, about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. And they were all amazed, and were in doubt, saying one to another, what meaneth this? Others mocking said, these men are full of new wine. Well, who do you think these others are going to be mocking you when the time comes? Oh, they're going to be those holy religious types in our time, you know. Satan's made them big time boys in his kingdom. And what do you know, right? I've had people like that on my wall let me know that I don't know nothing, especially who the 144,000 Jews are. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. You can read that in Joel chapter 2, verse 28, I believe, is where it begins. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heaven above, and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood, before the great and notable day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. You're wondering why I believe that many are going to snap out of it, deceive Christians? Because of one of the statement right here, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Just like in the book of Malachi, God said he was going to send Elijah the prophet. And he's going to turn the hearts of the children to their fathers, plural, meaning two fathers. The true father, our heavenly father, Yahweh. And the fake father, the father of the sons of Cain, Satan. There's going to be no sitting on the fence during the tribulation. You're going to choose one, or you're going to choose the other. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. For David speaketh concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, also my flesh shall rest in hope, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Jesus did not see corruption. His body was not in a grave. It went to heaven to be with our Father. His body was transfigured. There was no body to be corrupted in the grave like our bodies are corrupted when they go into the grave. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God has sworn with an oath to him, that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne, he, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither did his flesh see corruption. Jesus did go into hell for 3 days and three nights. He preached to those prisoners that were there the gift of salvation if they would believe on him, and he took many of them across that gulf into paradise. You can read of this in 1 Peter chapter 3 and chapter 4 for your own studies, your own documentation. And Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we all are witness. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, He hath shed forth this which ye now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, The Lord said unto my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand, until I make thy foes thy footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made the same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Jesus. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and said unto Peter, and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is unto you, and to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, Save yourselves from this untoward generation. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. That was my whole point to it. And as you can read through the book of Acts, the church growing and growing and growing, and the Holy Spirit speaking through them. So what do you suppose is going to happen when you allow the Holy Spirit to speak through you? I'm sure there's going to be many deceived Christians that are going to snap out of it. They're going to repent of their false doctrines that deceive them and call upon the name of the Lord and shall be saved. I don't believe it's that far-fetched and that far-stretched to believe this. These last three studies that I've done, I'm trying to hammer this point home. Many don't want to believe it. Well, hey, don't believe it. You know, I don't care. To be honest, I'm not trying to please anybody. I'm trying to please my Heavenly Father. And I'm trying to look at this within the realm of sanity. You know, where am I going right off in left field here? Now we're going to see a type of the gainsayers. A type of when you allow the Holy Spirit to speak through you, like we learn about in Luke 21, that even the adversary shall not be able to gainsay nor resist. Actually, I learned this from studying my companion Bible by E.W. Bollinger. E.W. Bollinger pointed this out. Chapter 4 and chapter 6 of the book of Acts, there's a type of the gainsayers not being able to gainsay against you. And in this case, Stephen. And in those days, when the number of the disciples were multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, It is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among seven men of honest report, that number seven, spiritual completeness, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom ye may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, whom they set before the apostles. And when they had prayed, they had laid their hands on them, and the word of God increased, and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. What was happening at this time? The Holy Spirit was being spoken. The word was spreading throughout Jerusalem, throughout the world eventually. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. How did Stephen, was Stephen able to do these wonders and miracles? It was through our Heavenly Father and His Holy Spirit. Because without God, we can do nothing. Any spiritual gifts that you have is because God gave them to you, not because you're some great wonderful person that is just so smart you can figure all this stuff out. And I'm not trying to insult anybody. Just give God the credit where credit's due. Because without God, we could do nothing. Without God opening your eyes, we could see nothing. Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines, and the Cyrenians, and the Alexandrians, and of them of Cilicia, and of Asia, disputing with Stephen. Yeah, you're going to meet opposition too when the time comes, when the Holy Spirit speaks through you and you're delivered up. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. Then they suborn men, these are worthless men here, which said, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. They didn't hear him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. They're liars. And expect that when the time comes, the sons of Cain, Satan and his fallen angels, when our Father is speaking through you, well, they're going to be speaking lies against you to try to deceive whosoever. They're going to deceive, to be able to deceive. If for some reason why there's a bad, there's a battle of Gog or Gog and Magog and the battle of Armageddon, you know, who's there to go to war against at this time? It's written, Satan comes in peacefully and prosperously and deceives the whole world. Well, who's there to go to war against towards the end of this? Obviously, the Holy Spirit speaking through you must be causing something to happen to cause Satan to gather an army together. Why else would there be an army gathered together? I don't know. I guess you got to think on some of these things for yourself, I guess. Anyway, I'm running out of breath. My throat is dry. I'm getting a little worked up here, but it's all good. Thank you very much, guys, those of you that have subscribed to this channel. I'm trying to do my best. I'm not a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse teacher by any means. I learn from teachers that teach chapter-by-chapter and verse-by-verse. The Shepherd's Chapel for one, Just Thought Studies for two, Mark 13 Records for three, TheSeason.org. If you're not into watching YouTube videos, you can read the Word of God, pick a book, read it chapter by chapter and verse by verse. And the teacher, I think Roger Christofferson is his name, does a commentary. Teaches you the deeper things of the Word. To me, it's very beautiful to have all these wonderful teachers. I learn different things from each teacher. It's amazing to me. Just like God has shared his truth throughout the prophets, throughout the apostles as well. You know, it seems like God is sharing his deeper in-depth truths within his elect at these end times, where we're learning the deeper meanings to his word. I think it's very beautiful and I enjoy it very much. And as far as the delivering up goes, don't worry about it. You know, don't stress about it. It's not going to be a big mystery when it happens. You know, tune into my channel. Tune into their channels that I just said. Somebody's going to be putting the warning out when all this takes place. And remember, don't run out there trying to stop everybody from worshiping Satan when he claims to be Jesus, because nobody's going to listen to you. What did Jesus say himself? When they come to deliver you up, they will come for you. If you are God's elect, Satan knows exactly who you are. He's got your address. He's got your phone number. My smartphone's logging everything according to these stupid documents, these Vault 7 documents or whatever. They know who you are. So whatever. There's nowhere to run. There's nowhere to hide. Why would you want to run? Why would you want to hide? Just wait. Be patient. You know, leave it in our Father's hands. He knows what he's doing. So with that being said, guys, God bless all you. Thank you so much for listening to me ramble on here. And hopefully this has helped somebody. And, you know, tell our Father that you love him and do some work for him yourself. Plant some seeds. You know, the harvest is ripe. You know, now's the time to do it. Spend some time in our Father's Word. That's the only way you're going to learn, is to spend time in it. You know, Pastor Murray said in one of his videos, it took him 4 years to teach the Word of God, an hour a day. 4 years to get through the entire Word of God. So, you know, speed the process up a little bit. You know, as much as you can handle. You know, it don't take much to learn the overall plan of God's Word. It really doesn't. But if you want to study more in depth like I do, well, take the time and do it. That's the only way you're going to learn. You know, you got to meet God halfway. He's not just going to beam all the information in your brain. It don't work that way. God likes can-do, hard-working type people. So, God bless, guys. Until the next time, whenever that may be.